Well, hello, everybody. It's so good to be back home. Jeannie and I are always on the road. We oversee hundreds and hundreds of churches on your behalf. And thank you for sending us as your missionaries. How many know pastors need to be pastored? And so we're just very honored, but great to be back home. I want to talk to you today from my heart about bursting at the dreams. Bursting at the dreams. I want to warn you, I'm on fire. And if you want to stay in the routine and the mundane, you better get up and get out, because there's going to be a fire that's going to awaken inside of you, because God has invested a dream in all of you, you, those watching online. I believe it was 2010. The New York Yankee Stadium had just opened, the new one. The Yankees had played just a few games. But prior to that, they had called Pastor Joel, our pastor, and asked him if he would be willing to come to Yankee Stadium to host an America's Night of Hope. Well, we prayed about that for a few seconds. And so it was. We went to New York Yankee Stadium. Outside of two or three baseball games, we were one of the first events to ever go there. I'll not forget that day. It was a day I'll always remember. Pastor Joel and I were walking around. It was surreal walking around the Yankee Stadium. No one was there. Everyone was working, getting it all set. In just a few hours, it would be sold out. And in just a few hours, we would see over 30,000 people give their life to Christ. It was one of many, actually one of 196 arenas and stadiums that have brought the gospel of Christ to this nation. Pastor Joel and I walked up into the high seats at the top of the stadium and looked down and watched all of the activity as it was getting ready. And I said to Pastor Joel, I called him Joel, but he's Pastor Joe. I said, Joe, did you ever imagine this would ever happen, that you would be preaching at the Yankee Stadium? And with that fusion of confidence, calm, and graceful humility, it was quite a surreal moment. I said, can you imagine what your father must be looking and seeing? His son, camera guy, about ready to preach to 50,000 people. What about your mother? You know, we're coming up on 60-year birthday for Lakewood Church. Could we have ever imagined this would happen? And I, at that point, Jeannie and I had volunteered for Lakewood Church and for serving Pastor Joe for nearly 10 years. That's why I love the volunteers of this church, because I'm one of them. I served for 10 years at our own expense, and I believe that when you find somebody that's changing the world, your ability to change the world starts by serving those that already are. And then I said to Pastor Joel, I called him Joel. I said, Joel, you actually liked to play baseball, didn't you? You actually played competitive baseball. Yeah. I didn't really know. And I said, so did you ever dream of playing baseball? Yeah, every boy, every young man believes in that they're out there doing all the hard work that one day they'd play. And I said, what position did you play? I didn't know. He said, second base. So help me, about that time, the team was putting the podium on the stage right over the second base at Yankee Stadium. I said, Pastor Joel, I called him Joel, you're playing second base tonight at Yankee Stadium. You see, dreams are not just fantasies, passing thoughts. Dreams are seeds that God invested in you before time began. Dreams are not options for the few and selected. Dreams, in fact, are your obligation. It is the rent you pay to live on this planet, to grasp your dreams and go after them. In fact, dreams are your opportunity to make a difference for eternity. Dreams are God's GPS system, sending you signals of what your purpose in life is. And every dream God gives you is another way of saying, thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth. As is my dreams, so be it on earth. Every dream is a part of the puzzle of God's purpose and plan on the earth, of which you play an important role. You mustn't give up on your dreams. You must not let your dreams pass. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2 and verse 17, when Peter was preaching on the day of Pentecost and people were being filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking with tongues and prophesying, signs and wonders were exploding, and people were saying, what means this? What is going on? And among all the signs and wonders that the church was about to do, what he said in verse 2, verse 17, is really the most important, above the gifts, above every miracle. He said, Joel the prophet has said, in the last day, says God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy, and your young men will have visions, and your old men will have dreams. Can I tell you, the gifts, I love them, great. The power of God, I love them, great. I love all of that. But all of it is so that you can be empowered to live your dreams, because in fact, your dreams are not yours. They are God's investment in you so his kingdom can advance. I'm talking to your dream tonight. The word dream in the Hebrew is an interesting word that I don't know how to pronounce. But it means in part to bind firmly, and watch this, to be full, to swell, to be plump. You know, often in the Old Testament, the word fat was used as a way of expressing wealth, and you shall eat of the fat of the land. Back in those days, if you were pleasantly plump, you were wealthy. I'm not going there. But that's the ideal of what I want you to see and feel tonight when I say you have a dream. I don't want that dream to be weak and anemic. I don't want that dream to have a tiny fading voice that surfaces every once in a while to the top. I want there to be a dream inside you that is swelling, that is bursting at the dreams, that no matter what your job is and no matter what you're doing, that somehow you touch it with your dream, and your dream is touched by everyday life. Do not be drawn into the rigor and routine and the rut that the enemy would like you to drift into. Do not be confused by the maze of mediocrity, but allow there to be this dream inside you that you listen to, you hear, and you follow it. It's God's hints of your purpose in life. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy 1, verse 9, he said, Timothy, you must understand that God called you long before your mother and father ever met. God called you actually before you were ever in your mother's womb. Actually, listen to this. God said, Paul said to Timothy, God called you with a holy calling before time ever began, before the first tick-tock. God already knew when you would be born, where you would be born, by whom you would be born through. And inside you, he put eternity inside you, and it manifests by the dreams that you have. Your calling is calling tonight. You up in the back, all of you here, the little children watching online, Dreams are your connection to the purpose and the passion and the calling that God has put upon your life. Never, ever be talked out of your dreams. Never allow dreams to be lost. Pastor Joe told a story about me this past Sunday. I dreamed of wanting to be a disc jockey. Most of you don't even know what that is. They don't have them anymore. But back in my days, the disc jockey were kingmakers. They get on the radio, they play your music, you're a star. I loved radio. I loved being a disc jockey. And I was raised very strict. We didn't have a TV. We couldn't play organized sports. I mean, you know, our theme was we don't smoke and we don't chew. There's nothing we can do. We are happy people. Yes, we are. But every day I'd come home from school and I had a reel-to-reel tape deck and I'd clip off newspaper articles and then clip off commercials from the newspaper since we didn't have a television. And I would make up commercials and I would make up the news. And I had two turntables and a mic hanging from the ceiling. And I did the Mike Phillips show every day, 1 hour, to an audience of millions. And incredibly, I auditioned for an internship, and there was over 300 students that applied, and only 12 could be accepted, and I got accepted. But don't clap, don't clap, don't clap, because my mom and dad felt called to start a Christian school. And of course, I was the preacher's kid, and I had to go to it, and when I did, I disqualified from being sponsored by the public school system, and I could not go, and I could not work at that radio station, and I was very upset, and I was very angry at God, at my parents, and I thought, that's just like God. He knew this would make me happy, and he took it from me, but I got over it. God called me in the ministry. And I started living a life that was incredible. And I have experienced so many great things in my life. And we were at a stadium, and I just finished interviewing some great pastors. I took the headset off of my ears and laid it on the table, and God said to me, "There." And I knew what he meant. There, and I interrupted God in my mind and said, "Oh, no, God, that was a pipe dream. I was just a kid. It doesn't really matter. I got over it." No, you desired it. It was a dream. And Phil Munsey, when you dream something that comes from me, 45 years later, I'm on Joel Osteen Radio fulfilling a dream. I'm telling you today, if God gave you a dream, if it takes 45 years, don't let go of your dream because God hasn't. To allow that dream to keep alive, to fuel it, to feed it, to follow it. Jeannie and I were talking about dreams, and we were talking, kind of reminiscing. This weekend, Jeannie and I will celebrate 41 years of marriage. Yeah. We got married at, no, never mind. And we're just reflecting back on our lives. 44 years in full-time ministry, 41 years married, both of us pastors, and just thinking about the radio thing and just thinking about the different things. And we started reflecting on Jeannie. She went to a very small church in Southern California. Her father was considered not even saved, but he believed in his kids and pushed them to sing, to learn the piano. Jeannie's very quiet, very introverted, but her dad would give her 25 cents to sing. And though she was shy, she's a sharp businesswoman. And she got over her shyness to get that quarter, and that was 55 years ago, when 25 cents was worth 25 cents. Her and her siblings started a group that became nationally known in the gospel field. Her brother wrote a song that was nominated for a Grammy. Jeannie went on with a solo career and sang with some of the greatest choirs and sang at conventions and conferences and became very well known. That's why I went after her. Recorded an album, did some music songs. Maranatha who was the original worship industry that started the worship movement, selected one of her songs, Precious Lord, you can Google it, and then re-recorded it again as a classic. Pastored at 50, she realized that she had two things that she was afraid of. Number one, she was claustrophobic. Number two, she was afraid of heights. But her father had trained pilots in the war. And there was something inside of her that said, at 50, I've always wanted to do something that would make my dad happy. So at 50, in spite of claustrophobia and afraid of heights, she went and got her airline pilot license. I'm like, you go, girl? And as we were reflecting, we realized that God had answered our prayers and our dreams. And Jeannie said this to me, I didn't dream big enough. Phil, I've got to dream again, because every dream I've ever had has come true. Let me tell you something. How? I can't tell you. When? I can't tell you. Through whom? I don't know, and you'll not know. But if God gave you a dream, that dream cannot return back to God void. You embrace that dream. And I know a lot of people talk about dreams, and in the world they talk about dreams. And often people ask me, what's the difference between a dream or a fantasy? How do I know it's from God? I have a little test that I ask people to do on themselves. Ask yourself, if the dream comes true, who benefits the most, others or you? You want that again? You're not going to get it. No, I'm teasing. So how do you know? Because the world is constantly talking and pounding our heads with popularity and how many followers you have and having wealth and money and all of these things. And is this my dream? I don't know. Ask yourself, if the dream that I have, if it comes true, who benefits most? Others are you. And in that filter, you will cleanse, shake down, trim some of the stuff that doesn't matter, and it will purify your motives, because when God gives you a dream, that dream will never die. And you say, how do I find it? How do I start? My mind cast down images and imaginations. I don't know. I think I lost my dream. So let's continue the quiz then. Ask yourself, what makes me tick? What do I love doing? What is my desire? If you won the lottery, which you never will because you don't buy tickets. But let's just say you went and got a Slurpee and you get in your car and there's a ticket on the ground and you pick it up. It matches and you're $40 million wealthy now. So now you spent a few million, you've given a few million away to friends and family, and you're stuck with another 20 million. You're like, what am I gonna do? Ask yourself, what would I do if money wasn't a factor? Now you're getting close to listening, to hearing the dream that God has put in every one of you. Ask yourself this question, what makes me ticked? What hurts me? See, all dreams are connected to pain. All dreams run on the fuel of passion. Passion means to have suffered, to have been vexed. Passion doesn't come as some romantic energy that comes on you. No, passion comes from where you've been hurt. You see, when you get that which you desire, that which makes you glad, and then you attach it to that which makes you ticked and that which makes you mad. When you put those two together, you have now narrowed down and now are now getting focus on the dream that God wants you to be bursting with today. Don't be afraid of your pain. In the words of the great theologian Garth Brooks, I would have missed the pain. I wouldn't miss the pain that I would have missed The pain is part of the dream. Don't resist it. Don't go numb and number, because it carries something. And then number three, ask yourself, what trickle down equity is in my lineage? Because dreams grow up to become legacies. When a dream grows up, it becomes a legacy, which means it becomes transferable from one generation to the next. And in every deed is a seed, because it's not just about you and I, and it's not just about now, but it's about advancing the kingdom of God. And every dream is nothing more than saying, thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Dreams. I had a dream secretly of being on the Larry King show. Some of you don't even know who Larry King is. Google it tonight. Not now. Larry King was a king. Back in the day when prime time, the Larry King show for 1 hour had the most prestigious and influential people in the world, kings, leaders, name it. They were on the Larry King show, and secretly I fantasized about being on the Larry King show. And an incredible tragedy that turned into a miracle happened to a member of my church. She was biking through the canyons when she was attacked by a mountain lion that had already killed a man earlier that morning. The mountain lion leaped and grabbed her hold of her face and her helmet and pulled her down into a ravine. Moments from being killed, bikers threw rocks until they finally scared the lion off. Miraculously, in a helicopter rushed to the hospital, the doctors put her face back on, and she lived. It was an incredible story. It went international, and Larry King wanted her. Ironically, it happened by my house. I happened to be driving by when all of the drama was happening. I was involved. Larry King wanted the story, and I was gonna be on Larry King. Makeup on. Ann and her husband James ready. Here we go. So help me God, 2 minutes before the show starts. In Kuwait, there was an airstrike. We got preempted by 15 minutes. That was my segment. Ann and James went on, told their story. Millions of people were touched. I was that close. That close. Now the word was that Larry King was going to retire, but you see, a dream never dies. A dream never dies. Bursting at the dreams. Get you a dream. Get you a dream. And don't let go of it, because God won't. Years ago, I preached a sermon. Don't kill your dreams. Execute them. Find a wow, ask how, make a vow, find your owl, get the pow, and start now. You want that again? Buy the tape. No. Get your wow back. Get your wow back. Who took your dream from you? Who said it's over? Who said that it's an ego trip? No, it's not an ego trip. It's the kingdom of God trying to birth and expand through your dream, bursting at the dreams. Today, Pastor Victoria's book, second book in 10 years, came out. Pastor, can I have this? I want to read a story to you. This message is brought to you by The Exceptional You, written by our pastor. This story is meaningful to me, and you'll see in just a moment. Pastor Victoria writes in Make Every Season Count. A friend of mine told me about a time when she was 18 years old, and she had offered to deliver dinner to a guest minister's family. Upon entering the small apartment they were staying in while in town, she saw a mom with two boys, one on each hip. while two other boys were running up and down the stairs in the midst of a loud, energetic game. The mother smiled at my friend and asked if she'd just placed the dinner on the table in the kitchen. She then thanked her for her kindness and turned to get her children cleaned up for dinner. My friend walked out of the door and she thought to herself, that poor mother, four kids and running ragged, racing around just trying to keep up with errands and demands of motherhood. Not me, this friend said. I have too many dreams and goals to achieve for my life. That mother will never be able to dream again, not with the responsibilities of raising a house. Years passed, and after dozing off momentarily in her bathtub, exhausted trying to keep up with her three children, my friend began to wonder if she had missed out on her dreams that she once had, and as she began to contemplate the life and the season she was in, her thoughts went back to that day when she was 18 years old, delivering a meal to a young mother whose life she never wanted to have. Now my friend realized she had become that mother. But now she understood more fully who that mother was and what was happening in her life at the time. And despite her thoughts and opinions that day, that frazzled mother had gone on to become an international in-demand speaker, best-selling author. That poor mother that friend had seen was Lisa Bevere. It was just a season. I don't care what your circumstances are. It's just a season. If your dreams seem to have evaporated and are long disappeared and you have become that mother, it's just a season. If God gave you the dream, then God will give you a chance to see it. And oh, by the way, that friend was my daughter, Kara. And those three children, my grandchildren, thank you very much. And every time Kara teaches at the women's ministry, every time Kara takes another step towards her ministry, she's reminded that though it seems like they're long gone, a dream never dies. A dream, who am I talking to today that almost gave up, almost felt like your dreams didn't matter? One of the great joys that Jeannie and I had was to pastor Oral Roberts. And for many years, it was a joy to watch Oral Roberts walk in every Sunday at 11 o'clock in our church. An incredible man that you may not also know, but no man has ever laid hands on more people and probably never will in the history of Christianity. 1.5 million people. He sat down in a chair, talked to them one-on-one, and laid hands on them. Of course, Oral Roberts University. Of course, incredible impact. And it was a humbling experience to pastor him. Oral Roberts loved Pastor Joel and would often talk about how proud he was watching Pastor Joel. And I was very excited and worked out for Pastor Joel to come to Pastor Joel to Oral Roberts' home. And they brought the film crew. And I'll never forget the day when Pastor Joel and Pastor Oral were in the living room and the cameras were on and Oral was going to speak to Lakewood Church and then pray a prayer. Some of you may remember that. And I was so excited. And I'm telling you, that moment watching Joel, one of my heroes, and Oral Roberts, certainly one of my heroes, in the same room talking to each other. I was like, whoa. And while they were talking, I couldn't constrain myself. Amen. Ooh, wow. I mean, I have been with many famous people being with Pastor Joel. I remember the Vatican invited us, and I remember being in the audience of the Pope with Pastor Joel. But I tell you, that moment with Oral Roberts and Pastor Joel was the most precious moment of my life to watch. That Sunday afternoon, after it had been shown in this church, Pastor Joe called me and said, oh, the church loved it. Oral Roberts was fantastic. And when he prayed, you could feel the anointing. And oh yeah, Phil, everybody was laughing because they could hear you in the background. Yeah, amen. I asked Pastor Joe to come and dedicate our church, and he said he would. So him and Pastor Victoria made plans to come. It was going to be a Tuesday night. The weekend prior to that, Oral told me, I'm not going to be in church this weekend. I want to save my strength because I want to come and hear Pastor Joe Tuesday night. One of the things that Oral had said to me is, I hope one day Pastor Joe gets an opportunity to tell everybody that Dr. Paul came to ORU, and that's where he graduated from. And I sure hope one day he'll tell everybody he came to ORU for 1 year. I said, Oral, don't worry. Dreams come true. Tragically, unexpectedly, Oral had an accident that weekend and went to be with the Lord and wasn't there Tuesday night. The place was packed and we honored Oral Roberts. It was a sad day. But now, Larry King, literally days away from retiring, found out that Pastor Joe was in California and called him and said, I want you to come over to the studio, let's talk. Pastor Joe went. He was there on the Larry King show. I was watching from my home. Come on, Pastor, you can do this. They got talking. Larry King liked Oral and brought him up, said, I loved Oral. Pastor Joe said, I did too. He said, actually, I went to school there 1 year. Yes. My brother graduated and became a doctorate. Yes. Oral, did you hear that? And he said, Larry King looked at Pastor Joe and he said, you know, my staff did some research and they found this tape of you and Oral Roberts talking. They turned it on the screen, Pastor Joe, Pastor Oral talking. And then, amen. I made it. On the Larry King. Dreams come true. I wish I could get somebody bursting. They're not options, friend. They're part of your opportunity and obligation to the kingdom. When I wrote my book, Legacy Now, which is a huge bestseller.
And my family.
What? At one point, I got so discouraged, I thought, if I write this book, who's going to buy it? I'm just going to give the ideas away. My daughter, Kara, said, Dad, don't do it, because I got books in me. And if you don't take the first lap, if you don't start this dream, I'll never have an opportunity. I said to myself, this is not about me. This is not about now. This is about advancing the kingdom of God. And it's not about my ego. It's not about being popular. It's not about being wealthy. It's about if I see this dream come true, the kingdom of God will advance. It's not an option. It's an obligation. It's an opportunity to touch heaven. Because in every deed there is a seed. Everything about you matters. It's not just personal, it's generational with eternal consequences. And every tear and every trial and every triumph you go through matters. My father, before he died, the last Easter he was alive, he wrote a letter to us kids. See, my dad started a church over 60 years ago, actually now 65. He struggled. My dad had more tenacity than charisma and charm, never got invited to speak at a conference or was never a guest speaker. He struggled, but he was passionate. The church never got past 500, but he raised up a lot of great men and women in the kingdom. And after he gave the church over to my brother Steve, he went on, him and my mother, with a revolutionary concept to teach English in Bulgaria using Christian curriculum. And my father passed, my mother, like Pastor Doty, 86 years old, my mother decided she'd build a state-of-the-art school that was so significant that it won the Building of the Year for the state of Bulgaria. These are the kind of heritage I had in me. But my father wrote and said, according to my calculation, though our church never got past 500, that Friday night on Easter weekend, Good Friday, I happened to be speaking at Lakewood on Friday night. I spoke Good Friday. My brother Joe, children's pastor of a significant church in Southern California, ministered that weekend. My sister Sheila, married to Kevin Gerald, pastor in Tacoma and Bellevue, thousands attended Easter that weekend. And my brother Steve, who took the little church my dad had over 30,000 that Sunday. And my dad had calculated that his kids preached to over 50,000 people on Easter weekend. And though it didn't come from him, it came through him. A dream never dies. A dream does not come from you. It comes from heaven. And when you touch it, heaven touches you. Don't let go of your dream. Can I pray for you? Would you get your hands like this, like you're going to receive, and look at me as I say to you today, Mama, I know you're just trying to keep those kids fed and keep them going, and your mind is a thousand directions, and you're just trying to survive, but today, God says, the tree will not die. Oral Roberts said to me, one of the last things he said to me before he died, we had gone to ORU and the Greens, who had taken over from Hobby Lobby, assured that ORU would go on for generations. And as I looked at the campus, I said, Oral, what you did is amazing. Oral looked at me and said, the weight of every man's burden is the same. Whether you're raising up children or you raise up a university, you just do what God tells you. It's no big deal. I said to Dr. Roberts, oh, it is a big deal. And I'm going to say it to you tonight. It is a big deal. Whatever God has put in your heart, it is a big deal. And don't let it go. Now may the Holy Spirit come upon you this night. May the Holy Spirit bring a warm breeze over the chill of a soul that has got lost in the mediocrity and the mundane. May the Holy Spirit ignite the flame buried under the debris of life. Your dream matters. Your great-grandchildren will thank you for listening to this message and saying, my life matters. Be filled now. Thank you. The presence of God is here. The presence of God is here. His holy presence is here. He's sending forth a sound to you, to you, to you, to those watching. I'm with you. I picked you. I put a gift in you. Before ever, I knew when you would be born, where and when, and by whom I picked. And your dream and destiny is going nowhere without you. All I need you to do is let that dream be fed. Let that dream every day, just a little bit every day, do something. Move towards it. It will move towards you. Oh, Holy Spirit, 10 seconds for the Holy Spirit to touch every heart and to seal this prophetic word over your life. Would you just say, thank you, Jesus? Say hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many feel the Holy Spirit upon you right now? I know you do. I know you do. I know you do. You'll never be the same. You will not be able to walk out here the same. Welcome to God's world. Welcome to a world of dreams and vision. Is there anybody here tonight that will say, I get it, Phil. I get it, Pastor. I believe God is filling me with His Spirit. And somebody say, I'm bursting at the dreams. Does somebody over here say it? Anybody over there? Somebody shout it. I'm bursting at the dreams. Come on, can I hear it again? Over here. Now let me pray. No moving, please, these last 90 seconds. Let me ask you a question. If your heart was to stop beating and you were to face eternity, are you at peace with Almighty God? If not, I want to help you. I'm not here to condemn anyone. I'm here to help you find peace. And I believe that comes only through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. If that's you, in just a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity to take a great, bold step of faith. Or maybe you've just drifted from your gift and your heart has grown cold towards God. And you need a fresh, new start. You need a new commitment. If that's you, I'm going to give you a chance to step out of the cold, step into the hot spotlight of God's divine will for your life. You say, I'll do it later. No, God ordained for you to be here tonight. Well, I don't want to stand. I don't want to do anything that embarrass myself or be a hypocrite. Listen what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you're not ashamed of me, I won't be ashamed of you. I'll back you. I'll back you. I'll help you. If that's you today and you want to make peace, you want Christ to be Lord and Savior, or you need a fresh new start, I want you to take a bold step of faith and stand right where you are right now. Just stand right over here. Anybody in this section over here? Beautiful. Anybody over here? Over here. This section. Anybody here? Look at this. Anybody over here? Any of our new time guests? God brought you here. You're not here for accident. Anybody over here? Remain standing, please. Over here. Anybody over here? Come on, Lakewood. Let's give God praise for... Just remain standing for a moment. Let's all pray this prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. You died on the cross for my sins. I repent of my sins. I confess with my mouth and I believe in my heart. Be my Lord and Savior. I believe that tonight God has heard you. And for those of you that have drifted and today you've stood to say, I'm ready to step into my destiny. God love you. God bless you. The greatest advice I can give you is to get into the house of God every time the doors are open. I promise you, you do that for the first year, your life will be the better for it. Amen. How many of you are going to walk out of here with a dream bursting? If that's you, stand to your feet. Otherwise, you're going to sit here all night. So you may as well decide you're going to do it. God love you. God bless you. What an incredible night. It's such a great honor to be a part of this family. I know you feel the same. Have a great week. We'll see you next time. God bless you, everybody. Amen.